Oops. So, let's think of kind of basics first. When someone comes into the emergency department as a cold stroke, what are the things that we focus on to kind of steer our hyperacute management? So what are things that you want to know on history and physical,
I guess? Well.
Yeah, whether or not they're a candidate for TPA.
Right. So what makes you, so you want to know, let's talk about, I guess, thrombolysis.
Sure, yes. Now we're going to be more broad.
So whether they're a candidate for a TPA, so you're looking for inclusion criteria.
Yeah.
So what kind of inclusion criteria do we have for TPA?
So within 4.5 hours.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. So
unless
we can,
onset, which still happens with everyone you talk to.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly, and sometimes, so yeah, it's important to differentiate between that, so symptom onset.
Yeah.
Also, if it's a wake-up stroke, very rarely you get lucky, and you can ask, did at any point during the night were you awake, and you guys have already both done that, so you know that. So inclusion criteria, so within 4.5 hours, the initial trial that showed us that is an IMDS within 3 hours. And then there was ECAS 3, which broadened the time frame to 4.5. And there's like numbers needed to treat, which I always like. So within the 3 hour time window, generally, at least in this trial, it was 8. And in ECAS 3, within this window, it was 15. So still pretty respectable numbers.
Yeah. And the thought is beyond that time frame, they're unlikely to benefit, or they're more likely to bleed, or both?
Both. Okay. Now, we did earlier talk about that possible 4.5 to 9 hour window.
Mm-hmm.
There have been some studies that have looked at that, all using perfusion studies.
Okay.
So basically, with the idea, if there's a mismatch, so
okay,
if there's a severe clinical deficit,
okay,
but a relatively small ischemic core to what you would expect, then there's salvageable penumbra. So like,
okay,
maybe, up to 9 hours,
okay,
but that would be a perfusion decision, and
sure.
Do we do that much here?
No,
I haven't really seen
you could. The only real purpose of doing it is in somebody who's not really in EVT.
Yeah,
I
was just
going to say,
like if our guy from yesterday did not have a cutoff, although I know his was like 2 a.m., so it was like maybe even borderline for that, but like if he had been solidly just out of the window.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so if he had been a complete wake up stroke,
yeah,
you could try to get perfusion imaging.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing you
yeah
could try to do is to see, the other way you can kind of tell is by doing a wrap, I shouldn't say rapid because that means something different in this context, but trying to get an urgent MR
yeah
to look at DWI versus flare.
Right.
So
yeah.
You could theoretically, that's kind of a poor MR perfusion.
Mm-hmm.
You can get actual MR perfusion in some centers, we don't routinely do that, but if you see an area of DWI that's affected, but it's
yeah
not present on T2,
yeah,
flare, that might be an argument.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there a specific ratio, or like regions one who can normal flare, or like half?
It's not that well defined, and so probably you would do it only if there's not really much on flare at all.
Mm-hmm.
The implication being that DWI changes we think may be reversible.
Mm-hmm.
The flare, once you get to that point, is probably well established.
Mm-hmm.
So these are inclusion criteria. There's also maybe an inclusion criteria you could argue for physical exam, although of course that has caveats.
Yeah.
How do we use our physical exam to make decisions for thrombolysis?
Typically, I mean, again, they use the broad terms like disabling deficit,
yeah,
but like I've seen the NH4 used.
Yeah, so generally that is the number that gets thrown out, but realistically speaking,
yeah,
the disabling nature of the deficit takes precedence.
Yeah,
yeah, that's right. And so plus disabling vascular deficit. Okay. So let's say your patient has both of those. Then what do you go hunting for next to make your decision?
Exclusion criteria.
Yes. What would make you gun shy about TPA?
We're actively bleeding.
Yep, exactly. Actively bleeding in the head or in the body.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. Active bleed. So that is an absolute contraindication. actively. When I was learning about TPA in med school, at least, I remember being given this like long list of absolute and relative. In the update, in like the 2018 best practice update, they kind of narrowed it down to really just this as an absolute criterion, and then shoved the rest of them into relative contraindication.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's obviously a lot, but we can talk about maybe like bigger ones. So what's some relative contraindications that you may have come across in some patients as well?
They have like a brain tumor.
Yeah, so they could lead into a tumor. So tumor inside you. So that's absolute.
Like platelets less than 50?
Yep.
And so that's not absolute A?
Platelets less than 50. So that is relative.
Okay.
Yeah. Platelets less than 50. You said tumor. Good one.
Isn't it like, I don't know, like a previous bleed in the last 3 months? Like brain bleed in the last 3 months?
Or stroke. Yeah, major stroke.
Or major surgery.
Or major surgery.
Yeah. Exactly. Or is that kind of...
Major surgery is like relative.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's the time frame's a bit shorter. So
it's like less than 15 days or something like that.
Yeah, I think it's 14 days or something. So
yeah,
it's 14 days for major surgery. And then stroke or ICH in 3 months, I think.
Okay.
And what would count as a major surgery? Like if they just got like a lap-appy or something? Is that...
I was wondering about that too.
Yeah.
I'm actually not sure what really qualifies.
So I vaguely looked this up because in the cardiac ICU, we end up with a lot of post-op strokes.
For sure, yeah.
Certainly cardiac ORs. I can pull up the paper. I found one paper for like 2017, 2018, and I can find it, but... certainly cardiac OR counts.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then beyond that, I mean, I think it's probably, is it a compressible site? Is it intracranial?
Yeah, true.
Like that would be a major surgery, even if they only did something small.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's another one listed too.
Any vessel anastomosis?
Mm-hmm. And also arterial puncture at a non-compressible site. It's also a relative contraindication.
Yeah.
Yeah, so these are some exclusion criteria. Okay, so let's say, you know, there's like many exclusion criteria.
It's like improvement, right? Or
yeah,
it's like a relative, but it's like the idea that there's another, or that it's not disabling, or that, I don't know, that it's not.
Yeah, so there is also a caveat to that, of course.
Yeah.
And I know we talked about that before. Lacunes. So, pardon?
Lacunes.
Yeah, so small vessel strokes. Just based on the fact that they can fluctuate wildly and can mislead you, and then improve and then deteriorate again by that time they're out of the window. Yeah. So that's also one we take with a lot of caution.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, so let's say that your patient doesn't meet any exclusion criteria and you want to go ahead. How do we administer? Oh, yeah, did you want to add something?
Oh, also anticoagulation.
Yeah, so anticoagulation is one. So let's say irreversible anticoagulation. Generally, we tend to send off studies, so we'll like send off anti-10A levels.
Mm-hmm.
And we can reverse anticoagulation in the acute phase as well. I think the different institutions use different cutoffs. In the guidelines, they recommend that if you're on warfarin, but you're at an INR less than 1.7, you can still go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
I think we may use 1.4 here. Am I making that up, Dr. Blacquiere? Or what do we use for an INR cutoff?
We use kind of 1.7.
Okay, so we're 1.7. So if you have INR less than 1.7, you're good to go. You can go ahead. Yeah. So how do we actually administer TPA? And I'm going to say Alteplase here.
Okay.
So I also want to talk about, just because of the ACT trial, I want to talk briefly about Tenecteplase as well. So Alteplase, what do we do? How do we dose it?
It's a bolus and then an infusion.
Yeah. No worries. So it's 0.9 mg per kg to a max of 90. And you give the first 10% as a bolus, and then the remaining 90 as a continuous infusion over 1 hour. A fun thing thing to think about is the actual half-life of TPA. So does anyone happen to know the half-life of TPA? I actually have to look this up. But it's surprisingly short.
60, it's like six, between 60 and 90 minutes, I think.
So the half-life of TPA is actually the terminal half-life, yes, that's right. So the terminal half-life is 70. The initial is like 5 minutes. Yeah.
What?
I know, right? 5 minutes is T1/2. And the terminal is about 70 to 80 minutes. So it kind of begs the question, why do we keep people inactive for 24 hours?
Because maybe swelling helps bleed?
You can get that. One of the things is also, and this doesn't happen in all cases, but alteplase can have downstream effects on other things within the coagulation cascade. So it's not, if we think about how TPA, if we think about how TPA actually works, so you have a clot here sitting in the brain, and you have a lot of fibrin within that clot. So TPA, and I'm using TPA right now to refer to alteplase, goes in, and upon binding to fibrin, becomes like the activated form of TPA, and that then converts plasminogen to plasmin. And plasmin then acts as a little Pac-Man and chews up the clot. So this acts here. So TPA, unfortunately, is not very fibrin specific. So it's relatively fibrin specific, but it has downstream effects on other things. So within the first 24 hours, you may actually see fibrinogen drop. Fibrinogen drop by 25%, which creates this early fibrinogen degradation coagulopathy that puts you at risk for ICH. And this half-life of the life of this outlasts the terminal half-life of TPA. In addition to this, you can have very minor, to be fair, alterations in APTT and mild decreases in INR. This happens in like 25% of people. So this is never really drastic or striking. You might get up to like 1.4-ish kind of thing. I don't know the exact cutoff, but it's not like going to be 2 or more generally. So this is why we like to monitor people a little bit more. So yeah, just a practical tip for that. Then we can talk about TNK, which is tenecteplase, since we're now starting to see it more in the ACT trial. So tenecteplase has actually quite a few proposed benefits over alteplase. So tenecteplase was initially approved, I think, in 2000 for the treatment of acute MI. And they, from those studies, inferred a lot of benefits over alteplase. Does anyone happen to know any of them? And it's totally fine if not, because that's pretty advanced.
I think the administration is...
Yes, that's a big one. Yeah. So how do we administer TNK?
So with TNK, I don't think you need to have it as like an infusion.
Good, right? Yeah.
Then you just kind of push and then you flush.
Yeah, it's a single IV push over a minute, which is like, if you compare that to having to set up an IV pump, especially if you think about doing this in rural centers, in communities, or mobile stroke units, it's a nightmare. Yeah. So IV push. Anyone know any others? There's a few, but kind of obscure.
Is it more specific?
Yes, it's more fibrin specific. It has a slightly longer half-life, so it technically sticks around to do the job for longer. The half-life of TNK is 20 minutes, I think, with a terminal half-life of like 120 minutes.
What's the dose of TNK?
So the TNK dose is disputed. So in ACT, we use 0.25 megs per keg. In the trials that looked at tenecteplase initially, so like the TNKT2B and like the NorTest and ATTEST trials had varying doses, and they also had 0.4 milligrams per kilogram. So it's a bit disputed right now, but I know that we're trying 0.25. Not sure if one has yet to be established or to be more effective. Pardon?
No max.
No max? I actually don't know how to exactly calculate it. That's a good question. Dr. Blacquiere probably knows. There's another couple of quirky things. It has less PAI resistance. Have you guys ever heard of PAI?
It's PAI.
Is it something in Asians?
I don't think it may actually be. Now that you mention that, it may be upregulated in people of Asian descent. I'd have to look that up. I know that it is. Oh, do you know?
I don't think so.
That's just like a wild
but it's like it's not like it's not cytochrome.
Okay.
It's like a plasma antigen activator.
Correct. Yeah.
So
basically, PAI is upregulated in all the people who would generally be your stroke patients.
Oh,
so it's
yes.
Upregulated in people with obesity, with hypertension, with decreased glucose tolerance, including diabetes. It actually acts as a direct inhibitor of alteplase. Which is pretty crappy. And TNK doesn't have that. And another nice thing is that it's also slightly cheaper. I think we may be talking about a difference in like the tens of dollars for things that cost thousands, so arguably, you know, negligible. But yeah, that's why we're studying Tenecteplase. There was all these old trials. So we're evaluating it kind of head-to-head with TPA. So right now we're still not sure, is it 0.25 versus 0.4 mgs per kg? But we also, we have no indications for it yet in our Canadian stroke best practice guidelines, but we're always a little bit behind the states. The states already have indications for TNK. So they have class 2B indications for people who are also going to EVT. And people who are, so plus EVT, and people who have isolated small vessel occlusions.
Okay.
Basically no large vessel occlusions. And there's a bunch of centers that actually have become TNK centers in the States already. So like UTexas and Austin has, the UCLA Mobile Stroke Unit is using it. And I think UPIT also started using it recently. So we may be headed there.
I'm a bit confused because, so it's only if there's a large vessel occlusion, but that they go for EVT.
And they're also going for EVT. It's kind of a weird combination
like,
of recommendations, yeah.
Yeah, weird.
And then it isolated small vessels. So like it actually applies to a lot of people. So
the only people excluded are people who have large vessels who aren't going for EVT.
Mm. Which
weird.
Is not a lot of people.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Weird. Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, who knows? Like in our next update, we may start getting recommendations for TNK. So that'll be interesting to look at.
Okay.
What else do I want to talk about? Let's talk about complications. So let's say your patient got alteplase. What do you monitor them for?
Tongue angioedema.
Yes.
Yeah, I saw your note.
Two times.
Hey. When I saw your note, I was like, it's awesome. Consistent with the TPA.
It's because I bought coffee. They know that's what they
that's the problem. So
at least you know it really well. I was gonna say I read your note and
where's a lot. And I was like, oh, it's unilateral, so that means it's more. I was like, what?
Yes.
Unilateral.
It is unilateral. Which side does it affect?
Yeah.
So the contralateral to the side of.
What? So it's the lateral. Contralateral. Okay, it's the body affected side.
Yeah.
Probably what you meant.
Yeah.
It's contralateral
to the
lesion.
To the lesion. Yeah.
But ipsilateral to the side. Yeah, that's right. You're exactly right. Who is at higher risk for this? Because the baseline risk is 1-2%.
Oh, somebody that's on an ACE inhibitor.
Yes!
Yeah.
Okay.
ACE inhibitors.
Which is also
risk.
One of the patients.
Yeah. Yes.
You're literally killing me.
Yeah, we are getting a lot of high yield learning from our patients. And how do you treat this? Just for your notes in case you ever need it.
Solu Nebrol 125.
Literally
killing,
sure.
Yeah, Benadryl 50. And
yeah.
Then you could give ranitidine, but the evidence for that isn't that great, and like given that it's really not on our formulary anymore, you can get away without using ranitidine.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the same teaching, that was excellent. So it's 50-50-10, so 50 of ranitidine. 50 of hydaphenhydramine and 10 of dex, plus or minus.
Mm. On Oxidate, it mentions 125 of solumedrol.
Yep, so that can be given.
That's the equivalent, okay.
Instead
yep.
of the dex, right?
Yeah. And awesome, excellent. That's an obscure complication, but you aced it.
And is it mostly just tongue, or how often does it progress to anaphylaxis?
Anaphylaxis is 1% of all TPA cases.
Okay.
Yeah,
so it's real. Okay.
Yeah, you can see it progress to like the lips too, and that too will still be like the same distribution, like contralateral.
Mm-hmm. But then hers progressed to involve the whole thing, right? And that can happen too? But it should start unilaterally?
It starts unilaterally.
Yeah,
interesting.
Yep.
And then I saw you were monitoring her like every 10 or 20 minutes, and then you have to do that too?
It progressed really fast. Like, I don't know if that's like dependent on the patient, but
I imagine it is. I don't think there's a standard rule. You might actually know more about that, Alex, in terms of like angioedema progression to anaphylaxis.
No. I'm just like curious.
I mean, it's a good question.
So if like the immediate mechanisms are slightly different, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, theoretically, if it's pure and like if it's C1 esterase mean angioedema, you probably shouldn't have overlap with anaphylaxis.
Mm.
My understanding.
Awesome.
Okay. We talked about that.
Yeah. So actually, let's talk about bleeds just really quickly. Spontaneous ICH. What is your rate of spontaneous ICH in, let's say, actually, in someone who is not given TPA? So there's a baseline rate of hemorrhagic transformation, even if you don't give thrombolysis.
2%.
Close, yeah. So like the note's an obscure number because I'm taking from a trial, but it's 0.6 alone, without, so of all patients with ischemic stroke, 0.6 will convert alone. And you increase this risk. How far?
6%.
Yeah, so it's like 5 to 6%.
I feel like you increase the risk from 0.6 to
6. Yeah, that's right. So you have a 5 to 6% risk of a spontaneous intracranial hemorrhage. There's also other bleeding, so like non-brain bleeding, which is a slightly lower risk, so it's about 2%. And usually it's GI or genitourinary. So those are the most common other sources. So monitor for your patients for that too, which is also why we have restrictions on how quickly we can insert a Foley into someone who has TPA. Yeah.
Okay, but when the nurse calls me and says, are you going to come deal with his ruptured bladder because he's retaining and in so much pain, I'm like, okay.
Yeah, you can do gentle in and out if it's, if, you know.
She was like, oh, do you want to come do it? And I was like, absolutely not.
No, not within the first few hours. At least get yourself over.
She was so
over the
area. Okay, put a catheter, do it nicely.
Okay, so we have bleeding. Also, something I should just quickly mention is, do you know what? We've just been kind of killing it with door to needle times. Do you know what the actual target is?
As soon as possible.
Minutes. 15 minutes is door to CT.
Okay.
The ideal median target is 30 minutes. So they will give you like a target of 60 minutes, but they're saying that your median should be 30 minutes. So we'd like to use 30 minutes because we're keeners.
Yeah.
So yeah, we've been killing it. So yeah, that's kind of that. What else do I want to talk about? When I talk about complications, we generally like to talk about like numbers needed to harm. The most recent number I could find is like 126. So you need to treat 126 people with TPA to get one of these bad things.
What I find interesting is like this like idea that like, because the brains are so different, and there's like certain people that are definitely have brains that are more predisposed to bleeding.
That's right.
And like, why are they not, like, for instance, if you have like a diagnosis of CAA, like your brain is not the 6%.
No, exactly. It's not. What else puts you at higher risk of bleeding? So let's talk about that. So higher risk of bleeding, you already mentioned, so presence of, let's just link this properly. So you talked about presence of CAA.
I'm not AVM.
Size of the infarct? Yep, size of the infarct. AVM might. I don't have a clear confirmation of that in my head, but theoretically that makes sense to me. So CIA, along with that goes age, large size of infarct, type 2 diabetes actually, also makes you more susceptible to bleeding, because of bad vessels.
Yeah. But none of those things that go up, like, we would not TPA someone who did those things, right?
No. It's just one of those things where we would monitor.
In the background.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's that. When we talk about kind of number needed to harm and complications, we should also talk about the benefit. So does anyone have numbers? So we know that kind of number needed to treat within the different time windows. I guess the numbers that came out of the N90S trial were that they usually tend to use MRS at 3 months is kind of our standard approach to evaluating disability. MRS of 0 to 1 is what I said, right? Okay, I hope so. So 0 to 1 at 3 months. So they found that at baseline, not being given TPA, that number was about 39% for people not treated with TPA versus 54 with TPA. So the idea is that for every 100 people you treat with TPA, 15 more will benefit from disability-free survival. Okay, so we talked about TPA, TNK. Okay, any other questions about thrombolysis? We can go on to EVT, which is a much shorter section. So thrombectomy. So you gave your patient TPA, and you're moving on to this question next. What are things on history that you're going to ask about that would guide your decision making about this?
I mean, I think we still want to last seen well within 24 hours.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. So we are now up to a 24-hour window for EVT, thanks to Dawn and Diffuse 3. That was a common trial that were asked about. Dawn and Diffuse 3. So they've opened our window from like 68 up to 24.
In all comers?
Pardon?
In all comers?
No, that's my next question. So what are things that would make you not want to do TPA or EVT?
Like aspect score?
Aspect score, that's softer. What's one that we always ask about every patient and our social worker will almost kind of lead with?
Oh, functional baseline.
Yeah, exactly, functional baseline. So you need to be completely functionally independent at baseline. Yeah. Functional independence.
Not necessarily.
Okay.
So if you go by the strict trials, what they would have is that you have a baseline MRS of 0 to 2.
Okay.
So you're allowed to have some deficits prior, but the idea basically was, and this again, depending on who you talk to, that's kind of a research criterion.
Mm.
You want people you can measure a good recovery back to. That being said, if somebody came in with an MRS of 4 from the nursing home, and that was the difference, this might be the difference between back to where they were in an MRS of 5, we wouldn't necessarily dismiss it out of hand.
Yes.
There might be other factors that come into us that would make us do that, but if it's going to reduce that level of disability, same with TPA, depending on who you're talking to, that might potentially still be something you could offer for that front.
Mm-hmm.
Another example I have given is that once on telestroke, I arranged for EVT assessment for a guy with a known palliative malignancy.
Mm.
But he was at home getting palliative care and was out treating on his property and all of this.
Mm-hmm.
So the difference between functional independence for the time he had left versus bedbound dependence for the time he had left.
Mm-hmm.
Even though this guy had a terminal malignancy with a life expectancy in the order of weeks to months,
yeah,
we still decided at that point to try to go ahead.
Interesting.
For that reason.
I heard that if you're going to do EVT, at least in like the very few cases I've seen, that we use a general guiding of like 3 to 6 months of prognosis. Is that kind of the accepted number that you go with, or is it really case by case?
It's going to be like, this was a very special case.
Yeah.
If you use somebody who's not doing well with the prognosis of 3 to 6 months, it wouldn't be a consideration.
Right. Okay.
But yeah, if somebody has a deficit that would significantly change their level of dependence, and they've got a reasonable baseline, definitely with an MRS of 0 to 2, no question.
Mm-hmm.
3, usually we don't really think about it too much. Once you start to get to the people who have more, then it becomes a very, very careful consideration.
Yeah.
Oftentimes these people have comorbidities that might make it difficult anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not a hard and fast rule, is basically what I'm trying to say. It's kind of back in that you were talking earlier about relative contraindications.
Mm-hmm.
We consider it a relative contraindication.
Mm-hmm.
If that's fair.
Yeah. Very fair. Okay. I'll stick my good old MNT here. So depending on the study you look at, they go for anywhere from 3 to 7. Interestingly, I thought that the earlier trials found higher numbers needed to treat than done in diffuse. They were more in the 3 territory, which may have had to do with technological advances and provider experience and stuff like that as well. So EVT. Now, let's say that, so first of all, who is a good candidate for EVT? What would you want to see radiographically that would make you think about feasibility of EVT?
Oh, proximal big clot.
Yeah, so basically a proximal clot. And how do we define that?
Depends on who you ask.
Mm-hmm.
Very true. So I think we all can agree that M1 is totally good to go.
Yeah.
M1 kind of vessel diameter. Proximal M2s generally also are good to go. Once you go to distal M2, like from what I've seen, paths kind of diverge. Generally at our center, I think the approach is to go ahead and still consult and see, and then it's up to the interventional team to decide whether they are going to try for it or not.
Mm-hmm.
At M1.
Some of the INR people will also then counter them. We're happy to try to go in, but it's up to you to decide.
Interesting.
So
what do you do in that case?
So the way I've heard it basically said, like if you get some interventionalists are very much, yeah, let's go in.
Mm-hmm.
We think we can get it. Some interventionalists do very much, I'll go if you tell me a quarter trigger. So what do you think you want to do?
Mm.
So be careful about, you're not going to always going to be able to download this decision.
Interesting.
Our guy yesterday with the Nevo, he's someone that we probably would go ahead because he's got a disabling stroke and we really have literally nothing else that we can
do. Exactly.
If he were a candidate for TPA, we might make a different decision. Well, I think most people probably would still strongly consider EDT in his particular case, given everything else around it. If there's other factors, so if he has rip-roaring peripheral arterial disease and you're not able to access it through some of the other potential methods, so there might be other factors that would make it technically difficult to go back, in which case you might not take the chance for something you're not sure you're going to get after, versus somebody with a large or a tandem.
Yeah.
Inclusion.
Yeah. That's right. So generally, which actually reminds me about TPA. So TPA, I think as you all know at this point, is a very good treatment for small vessel occlusions. And small vessel occlusions tend to respond preferentially to TPA. They still have a baseline recanalization rate for large vessel occlusions. And it's not negligible. So it kind of depends on your vessel diameter. So in an M1, the numbers I've seen are they're quite low. So actually M1 I think was 15 to 30%. Once you get to M2/M3, it's 40 to 60. And the really awful ones of course are terminal ICA. And then you're down to like 10%. But these are of course very amenable to EVT also because they're so devastating, right? Because you're taking out the M1, the A1, and the PCOM. If you're really a terminal ICA. What are some complications you'd want to watch out for in EVT. So patient's back in NACU.
Grinding patella.
Yep, that's right. Complications. What else have we seen?
Dissection.
Mm-hmm. That's right. So dissection.
Distal emboli during the procedure causing like a worsening
yes.
deficit.
Yeah, distal embolization. And there's a thought that, which would make sense, that TPA helps prevent distal embolization periprocedurally or intraprocedurally. And then there's a risk of vessel perforation as well. I found so many different numbers for this, mainly because I imagine it's very center and operator dependent. Is 4% kind of high based on, because I've actually never seen a vessel perf here.
There's been the odd case.
Yeah,
it's
but you'd say less than 4.
Potentially devastating.
Yeah. So vessel perf intracranially.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, intracranially. Sorry, shouldn't have specified. Not great.
No.
Yeah. So and then I guess one last thing to talk about is when do we combine and when do we not combine? So right now, in broad strokes, anyone who goes to EVT will also receive TPA as long as they are a candidate for TPA, even if they have a large vessel occlusion, because of these numbers, we know that it has some effect. There are some trials now, or recently completed trials, that have looked at a direct to EVT approach, not using TPA. The four major ones, let's see if I remember them. So there's direct MT, which was a Chinese trial. There was DEVT, also Chinese. There was SCEP in Japan. And I think Mr. Clean No IV. So really kind of unfortunate, because these were all non-inferiority trials. So they weren't designed just as for superiority, but for non-inferiority. And as chance would have it, so these two were positive for non-inferiority, and these two were not. There were some drawbacks in some of these trials. So for example, there were concerns about delays to receiving thrombolysis because of randomization that ultimately could result in a median delay of like 10 minutes in some of these trials, which is not insignificant, considering that every minute without treatment, you lose about 2 million neurons. It's not little. There was a kind of meta-analysis or postdoc, whatever you want to call it, that looked at the pooled results of DEVT and SCIP. And the P for non-inferiority literally fell just short. It's 0.06. So they could not infer non-inferiority. So right now it's still not standard of care to not offer TPA if you are a candidate for TPA, if you are simultaneously getting EVT. And we're also seeing that in the American guidelines, the same goes for TNK, if they're already on route to EVT.